Ladies and gentlemen, today we're honored to hear Dr. Theresa Deisher, president of Sound Choice Pharmaceutical Institute, who's going to talk to us about how human beings are now being exploited for commercial products. Dr. Deisher earned her doctoral degree in molecular and cellular physiology in 1990. She has worked for some of the top biotech companies in the world, including Genentech and Amgen. She has issued 23 patents and 3 discoveries that are in clinical trials. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Theresa Deisher.
Well, good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for coming. And I want to thank Mike Bird for that wonderful introduction. As he mentioned, I obtained my PhD from Stanford University in molecular and cellular physiology. And then I spent my career in commercial biotechnology. About 4.5 years ago, I stepped away from that career and I formed a pro-life biotechnology company called AVM Biotechnology, as well as a pro-life nonprofit biomedical research center. And what I'm going to talk to you about today is some of the work that we do, the education that we do at our nonprofit biomedical research institute called Sound Choice Pharmaceutical Institute. And the title of the talk is The Commoditization of Human Beings for Commercial Products. Unfortunately, it might be more accurate in some cases to use the word in. The commoditization of human beings in commercial products. When human beings become commodities, as they have over the past 2 to 3 decades, with the changing values of Western civilization, we begin to use human beings for purposes other than those purposes for which they are created. We start to use human beings in biomedical research. For instance, we use fresh aborted fetuses on a daily basis in biomedical research. And when I say we, I mean scientists and the field in general. Scientists use embryos and women's eggs for stem cell research. And from there, we move on to exploiting human beings for actual medical therapies. Cell lines that were made from electively aborted human fetuses are commonly used to manufacture vaccines, biologics, and now even cosmetics. While organ transplantation can be done ethically and morally, the huge demand for organ supply has driven organ transplantation and organ harvest really off the cliff, and many practices in this area have now become quite questionable ethically. We use embryos and aborted fetuses for actual human stem cell therapy. There's a desire to harvest circulating stem cells from children so that we can use their stem cells for regenerative medicine. And ultimately, scientists are moving rapidly into the area of reproductive cloning. I'm only going to talk about the bullets that are underlined today for the sake of time. I'll make another presentation in the future and hope that you'll come back to watch that about the uses of embryos and aborted fetuses for stem cell therapies. How did this happen? Where did this all begin? Well, it really began back in the 1970s with vaccines. And we accepted the use of cell lines that were created from electively aborted human fetuses for the manufacture of some vaccines. This was not necessary. It was a choice, and people were deluded into accepting it. From that point, things have only gone downhill. This is a list of some of the vaccines that are currently available in the United States that are manufactured using cell lines that were taken from electively aborted human fetuses. Human fetuses that were screened and selected exactly for this purpose. For instance, Poliovax is made using the human fetal cell line called MRC5. And all Poliovax-containing vaccines, including Quadricell and Pentacell, contain products from this aborted fetal cell line. The rabies vaccine that's made by Sanofi Pasteur called Imovax is also manufactured in an aborted fetal cell line. Now, in the case of the vaccines on this table, there are animal versions that are available. These are listed in green. And you can go to your pediatrician or your general practitioner and make sure that your children, or yourself in some instances, receive the moral versions of these vaccines. IPOL is a moral alternative for the Poliovax. And these vaccines listed here are alternatives that will give you all of the various vaccines you receive in these multivalent Poliovax vaccines. Additionally, there's a moral alternative to the rabies vaccine that's made by Chiron called Rabivert. On this slide is a list of vaccines that are manufactured using aborted fetal cells, and unfortunately, there are no moral alternatives in the United States, or in the case of the chickenpox vaccine, there are no moral alternatives that are available anywhere in the world other than natural exposure, which is still possible to protect our children from the varicella virus. Hepatitis A containing vaccines that are present in the United States, and also some vaccines where hepatitis A is mixed with the hepatitis B virus, are manufactured using the MRC5 aborted fetal cell line. There is a moral alternative available in Japan. It is not available here in the United States. And similarly, for the mumps, measles, rubella, the MMR2, the only mumps, measles, rubella vaccine available in the United States, this vaccine is produced using two aborted fetal cell lines. It's the rubella component of the MMR2, which is so problematic. There are moral alternatives that are available in Japan and Asia. Unfortunately, none of these are available in the United States. And our company, as well as our nonprofit organization, are working very hard to bring moral alternatives to the United States so that parents can protect the health of their children in good conscience. And also, regardless of your stance on women's reproductive rights, it's philosophically abhorrent to know that every time we inject our children with a vaccine that's manufactured using an aborted fetal cell line, that vaccine contains contaminants from that aborted fetal cell line, DNA contaminants and cellular debris. And so we are all participating in abortion by the use of these vaccines without our knowledge and without our consent. Just in case anyone here has been convinced by the argument that only one aborted fetus was used, and this was only done once, I have a list of the aborted fetal cell lines that are currently used in commercial manufacturing. As you can see, there's not one cell line, there's actually close to 30 cell lines, and these are not cells that are taken from an early embryo. These are cells that are taken from second trimester fetuses well along in their development, and the age of the fetus is listed here. These were normal fetuses. They were pre-screened and they were selected by the pharmaceutical scientists so that they could obtain good cell lines from them. Not only are aborted fetal cell lines used for the manufacture of vaccines and some drugs and cosmetics now, but scientists quickly moved to using this material for basic discovery and biomedical research. In 2010, the Puget Sound Business Journal highlighted Sound Choice Pharmaceutical Institute, and the title of their article was Grant Aims for Alternatives to Abortion-Linked Research. Now, to be fair, they contacted the other side and asked them about their use of aborted fetal material and justification for this. This is a statement from the Vice Dean of Research and Graduate Education at the University of Washington School of Medicine, located in Seattle, Washington. And as he told the journal, in 2009, they filled 4,400 requests for fresh aborted fetal tissue and cell lines. What's even more interesting, the source of the material that they provide to their investigators comes from a network of affiliated clinics that the University of Washington operates. So we now know that there's a very close association between those demanding the tissue for use in biomedical research and the suppliers of that tissue. A later report that was published last August in 2011 by Dan Devine in World Magazine told us a little bit more about this lab at the University of Washington, and we learned then that in 2010, that lab received $579,000 of NIH taxpayer money, money that was used to fund the procurement of aborted fetuses for biomedical research. So we are all funding this practice with our taxpayer dollars. In 2011, another report on these gruesome practices came out in World Magazine, written by Dan Devine. And what I want to highlight is that he also recapitulates what he learned, that electively aborted fetuses provide the majority of biomedical research material. Miscarriages are rarely used because the material is degraded and not useful. So that's another myth that is put out to confuse the public, that they're working with miscarriages. They're not. They're working with electively aborted human fetuses. It's important to point out and acknowledge that federal law prohibits the sale of electively aborted fetuses. However, there are loopholes in the law that allow these people, these organizations, to charge for shipping and handling and processing. I saw a catalog 15 years ago, and they charge very high prices. This is a very lucrative business, and after-expense profits for 1 month for some of these companies tend to be almost $20,000. So they're making quite a bit of money on this practice. We also learned from this report that not only are fresh aborted fetuses used in biomedical research, but what I knew from publications is now revealed to the general public, the fresh aborted fetal tissue is also used to treat patients. This doesn't happen just in the Dominican Republic or in Eastern Europe. This happens here in the United States. And studies with Parkinson's patients were done at Northwestern University, where they injected fresh aborted fetal tissue into the brains of these Parkinson's patients, which is revealed again in this report. What's also interesting is that it's our taxpayer dollars that funded this research, and $14.8 million of NIH money paid for these clinical trials that were largely unsuccessful, if not absolutely disastrous, to these patients. Another very interesting revelation that came out in this article is the concern by harvesters of these aborted fetuses that non-surgical abortions are interfering with their business. I just want to blow up this quote. They complain that the non-surgical abortions have created a deficit in the supply of U.S. aborted fetuses for biomedical research. And so we have to ask ourselves, where will these distributors go to make up this loss in material? Reporters are already uncovering where they have gone, and there have been some atrocities that have been discovered and published that have occurred in Eastern Europe. This is a publication in 2006 from the BBC, which is known to be a relatively liberal broadcasting organization, where they report in the Ukraine, normal, healthy, live babies suddenly die, and their parents are told that they die. Investigative reporters were allowed to dig up a mass grave, and when they did that, they discovered that these children had been dissected and harvested. The feeling is that they were harvested for their stem cells. So they're going to live babies. And then most recently, a very gruesome discovery was made in the Soviet Union, in the Urals, and they found barrels of hundreds of aborted fetuses that had been harvested for parts and for stem cells. What's also interesting is that on autopsy, they discovered that the mummified remains of those fetuses were 22 to 26 weeks. Now, this is illegal in Russia. Abortion is only legal up until the 12th week of pregnancy. I see that makes some of you gasp. If you read some of the scientific publications from the U.S. scientists, you would see that the aborted material that's being used is 22, 23, 24 weeks. There's particularly disturbing publications where they actually talk about the optimal age. And for instance, to get heart muscle cells, the optimal age is about 22 to 24 weeks. Again, what's most disturbing is that's an age of viability at this time with our medical technology. Unfortunately, the remains of aborted fetuses are not even sufficient to satisfy the demands of biomedical research and commercial products. And so they have turned to trying to exploit women for their eggs and their embryos for stem cell research. Scientists claimed, when they were looking for public support to do embryonic stem cell research, that they would only use leftover embryos from in vitro fertilization. Now, their claims were that there were over 400,000 frozen embryos that were going to be discarded otherwise. Unfortunately, only 11,000 of those embryos have been donated for scientific research. The rest of the embryos are being reserved by their parents for family planning, and also because those parents know that that's a child, even if that's a child in deep freeze, and those parents don't want their embryos to go for embryonic stem cell research. So that's the truth of the matter. There are not sufficient leftover embryos from in vitro fertilization. And what has happened, driven both by in vitro fertilization and stem cell research, is that an international black market has been created to obtain women's eggs. In many cases, reports tell us that poor and vulnerable women are being targeted. In the United States, they like to target the college students for in vitro fertilization. For stem cell research, we're going to third world countries and targeting these poor women. Many people are aware of the black market that exists for in vitro fertilization, and a documentary was produced by Jennifer Lahl on this subject called Exploitation, which is a wonderful documentary. And the tagline for their advertisement is that the infertility industry has a dirty little secret. Embryonic stem cell scientists have a dirty little secret too, and that's that they do the same thing. There are not enough leftover embryos, and so they exploit poor and vulnerable women and engage in international black markets and human trafficking. This is an excerpt from a colleague of mine from Nigeria who just submitted a protest about U.S. policies that encourage the exploitation of African women for their eggs. The GPA is the Global Pro-Life Alliance, and I want to just highlight they are complaining to the United Nations as well as to the United States that our current administration is pushing forward laws in countries like Nigeria and Uganda that encourage the harvesting and trafficking of women's eggs for embryonic stem cell research. To people living in Africa, this is akin to biological slavery and is actually a term that they use and very abhorrent to them. I want to also caution people, when embryonic stem cell scientists tell you that they're doing their research in an ethical manner, you want to be very cautious. So for instance, there are scientists who are promoting alternatives to embryo destruction called SCNT or ANTOAR. Now that sounds very good when you hear that an embryo won't be destroyed. However, most people don't know what those acronyms stand for. ANTOAR stands for altered nuclear transfer, oocyte-assisted reprogramming. And both of these alternatives require a woman's egg, oocyte stands for egg. So while an embryo may not be being destroyed in these practices, a woman is being exploited for her eggs, and in many cases, not in a medically ethical manner. So what are some of the risks to egg donors? In order to get eggs from these donors, they want to get as many eggs as they possibly can. And so they give these women hormones to induce superovulation so that they can harvest 20, 30, or 40 eggs. The risks of this include a syndrome called ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. In the United States, 1 to 6% of women who undergo in vitro fertilization or egg donation have this adverse outcome. Here we have the medical facilities to treat them well. Just imagine what happens to these women in third world countries where they don't have the medical facilities, and the number of cases of OHSS are much greater than those documented in the United States. Additionally, there's a transiently increased risk of breast and uterine cancer. Ovarian cancer is increased. There's risks of infection, of bleeding, and of subsequent infertility. So these are very significant risks that poor, vulnerable, and impoverished women oftentimes don't fully understand when they agree to donate their eggs because they're so desperate for money. When we accept the cannibalization of aborted fetuses for biomedical research, we quickly accept these practices for other purposes. For instance, to look younger, to have better tasting drinks and foods without the caloric consequences, to have delicious food without the hypertensive consequences of salt. Not to be left behind, the cosmetic industry has gotten involved in the practice, and now there are destination spas where you go not to have a facelift, but you go to have stem cell therapy instead. There's only one company, Neocutis, who is currently distributing anti-aging serums that are manufactured and contain components from an aborted fetal cell line. The company is called Neocutis. We are very concerned that with all of the new anti-aging products coming on the market, more companies may turn to these practices. Additionally, in Eastern Europe, there are destination spas where people can go to have fetal stem cell treatments or treatments with fresh aborted fetuses to counter the aging process. This is not hidden. Each of you could go on to the internet and you could type in the names of these companies that I have listed here, and you could pull up details of their spas and the therapies that they provide. This is an anti-aging treatment from M-Cell that's located in Ukraine, and I actually want to read this to you just because it's so disturbing. They offer effective anti-aging treatment with fetal stem cells. And then they go on to say, anti-aging treatment with fetal stem cells leads to marked cosmetic effects such as skin color improvement, fewer wrinkles, skin lifting, and sparkling eyes. I can't imagine anyone's eyes sparkling after receiving such a treatment. And while it may sound good in the short term, I doubt that in the long term, these treatments will have any good outcome. What's also more disturbing is they highlight the types of patients who come to their clinic. And they say that there are three types who come for their anti-aging treatments. The first group of patients are the absolutely healthy patients who just want to look better. And I will bet money that this is the majority of patients who are traveling to the Ukraine for these treatments. This is an excerpt from another destination spa called Sana Stem Cell, the world's largest clinical experience in fetal stem cell transplantation. And for over 17 years, they have performed over 6,000 fetal stem cell transplants. And then the third company is Fetal Stem Cell International. This is a picture of their headquarters. One headquarter is in Slovakia in Eastern Europe, which we've seen with these other destination spas. Another headquarters in Malaysia, a predominantly Islamic country, who would be absolutely appalled if they knew what was going on in this country. And I wonder if the people in the government know what is being done in this building. And then the last office for this company located in Switzerland. So no longer confined to Eastern Europe, but openly available in Western Europe as well. Not to be left behind, the food and beverage industry wanted to get into the game. And they have begun using aborted fetal cell lines to discover new food additives and flavor enhancers to put in our food and beverages. Now, with this practice, aborted fetal material is not yet in our food and beverages as it is in our vaccines or in the cosmetics like Neocutis' anti-aging or in the actual treatments. It's only used as a discovery tool. But if we do not do something to stop these practices with our penchant for protein-enhanced drinks, protein-enhanced foods, it is not unlikely that we will find in the near future that the aborted fetal material actually winds up in our foods and our beverages. Sonomics is the company leading the way, and they have developed a way to express special taste receptors on these aborted fetal cell lines. And they use their cell lines to discover small molecules that companies like Kraft, Nestle, Soleil Soybean, and Firmenich put into their products. Campbell's Soup and Coca-Cola had signed agreements with Sonomics to use their technology when they were contacted about the source of the cell line that Sonomics uses, which is an electively aborted fetal cell line. They immediately severed their agreements with Sonomics. Pepsi, however, who also signed an agreement, would not sever that agreement with Sonomics when they were informed about the source of the cell line. And this led to an 11-month international boycott that became very hostile. And I was surprised in April, after 11 months of hostility and some very harsh rhetoric on the case of Pepsi, to receive a phone call informing me that they had decided to stop. That was the last thing we expected at that moment. And they would no longer use aborted fetal cell lines to discover the enhancers that they would put in their soft drinks, which is a good thing, because Pepsi has a very long list of products. It's not just the Pepsi drinks. And they issued a responsible research statement saying that PepsiCo does not conduct or fund research that utilizes any human tissue or cell lines derived from embryos or fetuses. So this was a very wonderful outcome to a very long 11-month process. They gave in because the international boycotts, particularly in countries like Poland, were so successful that they lost money. So when human beings become commodities for medical therapies, we also go beyond ethical boundaries in getting organs for transplant. And I want to touch on this very briefly because this is an issue that I think we all need to start to readdress, because organ transplant is in such demand now. This is from a news report from California where a woman is suing because the doctors hastened the death of her son in order to obtain his organs. Now, he may well have died eventually, but he didn't die of his disease. He died because he was killed. And until someone actually dies, we don't really know that they're going to die or not, because miracles do happen, medical miracles, faith-based miracles. The public is becoming aware of the very aggressive harvesting of organs. And I know that many people no longer want to be tagged as an organ donor because of fears that if they're taken to the emergency room and they're young, they'll be harvested and not treated. So there's a big problem that has developed with our very aggressive organ harvesting, making people unwilling to even participate in the previously ethical practices. What's also interesting is that we now have a cutoff for comatose patients, and the cutoff is marked at this arrow. 72 hours after they're determined to be comatose, their ventilators would be turned off, and they would be harvested for their organs if their organs are viable. But what's interesting, a study was done looking at some patients who stayed on the ventilators for much longer, 96 hours, 144, or 252 hours. And what they found is that someone on a ventilator in a comatose condition who was on that ventilator for 252 hours went on to have complete neurological recovery. So the 72-hour cutoff is a very artificial cutoff. And again, we are probably cutting off and harvesting people who could recover and live full and normal lives. So those patients had good neurological recovery within 30 days. Because of medical progress and because of the widespread medical advances that are available to all of us here in the United States, and the United States is often on the cutting edge, we all need to become personally cognizant of bioethics. And when I say personally, I mean personally think about it and not just rely on some bioethicist at a university or some other organization. Many of these bioethicists are wonderful, wonderful people. There are some bioethicists, however, who really come up with justifications for universities or individuals to do things that we actually know are wrong. And what are some of the things that I think about when I think about bioethics in my own profession and in my own life? And you could use this as a guide when you think about bioethics. Well, first, I think about human life. Does what I want to do, scientifically or medically, take the life of another human being? The next thing I think about is exploitation. Will what I'm planning to do exploit someone else, whether it's a child, someone in poverty, a woman, someone with disease desperate for a cure? Will I exploit someone else? Is what I want to do actually good for the patient? Will this do harm to the patient, or at a minimum, do no harm? We've gone beyond the point where physicians used to say do no harm. They seem to have dropped that. We need to get back to the point where one of our first ethical pillars is, first, do no harm. I like to think about finances. From a Christian perspective, when I think about healthcare, I want healthcare that's affordable and available to everyone. For instance, embryonic stem cell research, so widely promoted by one political party and by some groups in the United States, will carry a price tag in the hundreds of thousands of dollars. In contrast, adult stem cell therapies will cost $25,000 or less. So from an ethical and a Christian point of view, we need to prefer the treatments that are just as good, but economically advantageous. We need to consider that. And finally, I always like to think about the finish. Am I promoting something that might have unintended consequences? And this is hard for the general public to think about, but it's something that all scientists should be thinking about, because we are at the age where human reproductive cloning is on our doorstep. And are we promoting things that unintentionally will facilitate that reality? So we all need to keep these things in mind. We know that we can stop these practices. The 11-month boycott of Pepsi worked. because Pepsi was hurt financially. Thimerosal, which is a form of mercury, was removed from the hepatitis B vaccines that are given to infants in the hospitals because parents refused to take the vaccine. Within 9 months, an alternative vaccine was available for all of these parents. So we know that if we refuse to use something against our conscience, alternatives will be available to us in a very short time frame. Some people are afraid to speak up about these bioethical issues because they don't want to appear to be not progressive. Okay? More importantly, most people don't even know what's going on. Does your family know about how vaccines and medicines are produced? Do they know about the international black market? They're ripe to learn about it because the news is now telling us about the international black market in human trafficking for sexual slaves. We need to become aware of the biological slavery that's occurring as well. Does your elected official know about this? You can make them aware of this because they can do something about it. At the end, we all need to step back, regardless of our religious views, regardless of our political views, and we need to ask ourselves, is exploiting other human beings for commercial products really progressive? And finally, we all have to ask, what will I do? What will you do about the information you've heard today? Thank you for your attention.